if they get a good start, if they get to the mid game without taking too many hits in the early game, then I would say Team Coast should be able to get the upper hand in this game. But if they don't, I really don't know how this game is meant to turn out.
Just sitting there being puzzled where I see a Viper picture and Troll Warlord underneath it. And I'm just like, what? Orange's name is Troll Warlord.
Wait, what?
Yes. It was like my brain just started failing as I was like, that's not a Troll Warlord. What? But we're good. We're good. So it looks like we are going to be having... So 8 Mother's going to be playing the mid. We should have a defensive tri-lane with an offlane Doom for Coast. We already talked about the dual lanes that are going to be run for VDVoem, which is going to be the Faces Void Lich at top. Viper in the middle, possibly. Well, he's going to be going up against a...
He's going bottom.
Razor.
They're actually pushing the Death Prophet towards the mid lane instead.
Yeah, that might be better. It seems like a lot of Vipers are avoiding the Razor matchup. Like, every single time I see Razor on one side, Viper on the other, it seems like inevitably the Viper ends up choosing a lane that is not matched up against the Razor. And I'm actually not too sure how that matchup really works. I don't think it's a clear winner one way or the other. I think Razor probably has a slight edge. But I honestly think it'd be hard to say.
Man, what happens when your supports don't want to stick around to give items to a Doombringer? Just leave him laying across the ground. There's 2 shared tangos just behind the tier 1 tower for him.
Yeah, they're lazy supports, man. They don't have boots.
Just a gift. No, it's efficiency, man. It's efficiency. Yeah.
It's like, I gotta go to my lane, and you're gonna be dealing with a lot of harassment here, especially when he's going for the boots first build rather than a stout shield.
Yeah.
He's dealing with a Viper safe lane, which is exceptionally strong versus these melee offlaners, because look how much distance you have to chase a hero. If he ends up getting even caught halfway through the lane, that is still more distance to chase somebody than you would have in the mid lane. And that's what Viper is strongest at, is being able to just constantly slow you down, get another hit in, and another, and another, and another. And as long as he's not having to dive into tier 1 towers, he will not stop. But at the same time, Boots will be able to help him out against that, because he's going to combine Boots with Scorched Earth, and he will actually be able to outrun the Viper and his, at level 1, 10% slow.
He could also just evade the entire thing, because as long as he evades Witch Doctor's first stun or make sure he doesn't get bounce stunned, he's okay. But this ward's actually kind of an interesting one. I kind of want to see him clear off this little tree, this one right here, so then he can get the proper vision across that side lane, because it doesn't fully show the tree line over on the right.
True, but
Witch Doctor could still harass him out of here.
It probably gives him enough vision of where the Witch Doctor is going to be at, and if you cut away trees like that, this is actually something I was having to talk to about the other day. There are certain things that you can do that will key off where your wards are at, and something like killing a tree like that is a big heads up. And this is unfortunate. It only gets the worst creep you could possibly get. It's an off.
The impossible creep to use, because you just don't have a mana pool in order to use it.
Yeah, I mean, Thunderclap is nigh useless, especially when you're dealing with dual ranged and now triple ranged tri-lane. And then on top of that, it's not a defensive ability at all, so no aura for him.
The Sash might be in a little bit of trouble. Maybe it's a good creep at the end of the day. Riptide with one more attack is good enough. And actually, the slow and the damage from the claps was able to ensure they got a kill. And that's easy skills, already having Bottle and a Doombringer offlane who takes the first blood. Not to mention experience, he's 2.5 levels. While Stepstar should be a little bit more careful up against Mayweather, but he'll be back. Maybe they could have pushed that, actually. He could have leaped and not just prayed for a time lock.
I suppose we should clarify. As a offlane Doom who actually sits in his lane, it is a terrible creep to have, because you would much rather have a health regen aura or armor or even movement speed at that point in time. Something to be able to increase your survivability. Thunderclap does nothing. But sometimes when you're forced into these situations where you do get Thunderclap, why not go for the gank in middle? It's if you can actually get close enough to land the Thunderclap, it is a very good slow in that regard. And it looks like Doom, well, this is one way.
He's giving tankos over too. Yeah, what's up?
He actually just took the bottle from the Naga Siren and is going to be grabbing the rune for him. And with this haste, I was going to say he was going to pop the haste and go give the rune back to Iskith.
They're coming back for mid, dude. I think the goal has got to be to focus on that middle lane and just shut him down.
And this is where the Lich needs to start moving around. There's no sense for him to be in this bottom lane anymore.
I'm actually surprised he's even here to start with. I thought they would have put, like, the Lich Void mid, knowing that Nagasaren should end up there. But now in comes Solon. He's got the Clamp of Marble again with the Haste Rune, but they force a TP out, and that's the Witch Doctor coming off instead of the Lich. But the bottle goes handed back over again. They force a TP, and that's a victory in itself.
Yeah, I'm not entirely sure why the Lich is bottom and not in the middle lane if the Death Prophet is taking a lot of harassment, or even at the top lane. Like, either lane I feel would be better for him than the defensive tri lane. It makes little sense for him to sit here, because the dual lane should be enough to keep the Doom out, and as long as the Viper is paying attention, he should be able to keep the creep wave pretty far back, close to their tower, and Doom just won't get anything except for the occasional devour creep from the jungle.
There it goes. Speaking of a jungler, we kind of forget about what Steph Star can do with that jungle. Oh, hello, Frigolite. Doesn't want to be that close towards Faceless Void. But maybe Ape Mother does. Well, Void, he just leaves himself away. It's an easy, easy lane-up for the Void to get himself out of that. But Steph Star, like a keeper of the light inside the jungle, he ain't a mug when it comes to farming. Surprisingly, though, he's not farming up stacks. It's just a basic camp, but with the Illuminate, you can easily work your way through a couple of camps.
Oh yeah, the best route is to get yourself to level 3 as soon as possible, and I think then start stacking up, because level 3 is what gives you infinite mana. If you're not using Chakra on anybody else, Death Style can spam out Illuminate every single time it's off cooldown, if you go for the second level of Chakra Magic right away.
DD rune taken up there by Witch Doctor. Notice the first item which Doombringer goes for, the Arcanes. Much better as he could possibly get into that hero.
It's an interesting... I would say it's not the most common build, but it's... Especially for offlane Dooms in these sort of positions where you're not going to be a strong carry.
Oh, Mayweather. You could be careful with that, Mayweather. He refused to time walk. So he gave a large amount of damage, 70 points went over towards the Razor, who took out almost all of his life points.
Yeah, especially if you're not going to be going for an early level of backtrack, with most offlane Voids do.
A surprise too, the Razor build. Like, we're not seeing any kind of phase boots coming out from Razor. If he had the high movement speed, he probably would have been a kill for just then. But he went Tranquil Boots instead on this safe lane Razor.
So I think this is going to be him... breaking up the Tranquil Boots. He will go for different upgraded boots later on, because Tranquil Boots simply do not make sense for a Razor going into the mid game. He's going to break it up. He's going to turn it into a Ring of Aquila and then use the Ring of Regen to turn it that into a headdress, which will go into the mech. It's a really efficient way to utilize your side shop. Because if you start out with a Ring of Protection, you never actually have to use the Courier in order to get those Tranquil Boots.
Well, you're right. He's actually got the chainmail over on himself. Yep. It's actually a really difficult hero to kill off. Mm-hmm. And I love this from Solon. He managed to get himself a Dark Troll Warlord Summoner. So because of that, he's able to farm up inside the Radiant Jungle, using the Army of the Undead to basically tank up for him. And because he's got the Arcane Boots, that's no problem. And soon, rotation towards mid. Smoke movement, in fact, Easy Skills is rather low, but now they're going to go Disruption, Catcher, Illuminate, there's a Troll Trap available as well, and Sash, okay, triggered the ultimate as well. This is a major loss for them. They've lost the ultimate and the crop.
It really is. I mean... The ultimate going down was just the cherry on top. It was silly for him to use it. I think it's silly in general for Death Prophet to try and get Exorcism at level 6.
If I say skilled at level 6. It was funny though, because we had a game, our first game of the day, where it was completely understandable that you would skill Exorcism level 6. Mm-hmm. Because there was just this aggro tri-lane that was not responding to you, so you could force the lane out early on. But you can't force anything up against a Nagasaren. Not a Nagasaren that's just able to run high mirror images as well as Riptide abilities, and you lose your creep wave. You can't push out of town with just a level 6 exorcism.
Yeah, I think you would be much more efficient for you to go for the levels in Witchcraft, and you even see him. This is something that Wagamama was harping on all the time during the TI4 group qualifiers, is that the Crypt Swarm, maxing it out is not very efficient for you. It's much more better for you to go for the Witchcraft, because that extra level in Crypt Swarm does not give you very much extra damage, just 50 damage in exchange for extra 25 mana cost. It's not a very efficient way of utilizing your mana.
So I'm going to say keep it 3, go 3-0-4-1.
Yeah, 3-0-4-1, and then go for that last level of Crypt Swarm. You could try and opt for a level of silence depending on what you're up against, but I would say against a Naga Siren, it's probably not necessary. Just because you're either going to kill her or you're not. I don't think there are going to be many situations where the silence is going to come in the clutch and stop the Song of the Siren from coming out.
Got a couple of guys in the chat saying, yeah, she can't disassemble Tranquil Boots anymore.
Oh, man.
So, not possible anymore. And that would probably explain the reason why the buckle and the headdress has already been completed, and he's still walking around with Tranquils on him.
You're right. I was thinking of the, I was thinking of the opposite scenario, which is where you go Ring of Bacillus, break that apart into Tranquil Boots plus Urn of Shadows, I think.
Right.
My bad.
I didn't want to question you, so I just led to a check question you.
Yeah.
Haste!
Sometimes you still get caught up in old mechanics.
Alright, let's go back to Warcraft 3 mechanics. The real mechanics.
Oh, it's not.
Yeah. Wait until all the mechanics start to get changed as well. People with their own little custom maps can modify the heroes and do all completely different things.
Yeah.
Looking forward to those days. Shout out to the guys who are recreating League of Legends in Dota 2. League of Dota, isn't it?
That's League of Dota? No, I think it's Defense of the Legends.
Defense of the Legends? All right.
League of Dota sounds better, but...
It does. But then again, like, then people be like, oh, it's too much Dota. And they may not mod up. They may not switch over. Anyway, back to the farming. We're 9 minutes in. Step style. I've hit level 5 as well. So with the 3 points, Illuminati is taking care of finally a couple of these stacks. While Naga Siren was also using her own illusions to do so. And this Naga Siren, 9 minutes in, is looking at Ring of Aquila, basic boots. The bottle's coming back, but sitting at 1500-ish cold. So that Radiance probably won't take too long to come up and running for the Naga Siren. Not the quickest Radiance we've ever seen, but at the same time, it's going to be a decent timing. And it's not as though, like, Coaster on the clock here either. Like, I know Void, Crob, and Viper could really hit him hard, but at the same time, you're still getting your mech up and running for a Razor. You're still, like, Naga Radiance, and Doombringer's managed to find level 7, and it's probably soon going to have a Blink Dagger as well. So the initiation could even come from Solon. And, yeah, I think this is now the point when the Radiance had to realize they have to make a move. So they four-man smoke up on the top lane to rejoin the face of Void, who was Chrono, and that's going to kill off Razor. Like, very quick snipe. Now, jump in. The Chrono will go, but the Chrono is very, very deep and looks to dive in so deep. SD, Disruption, and the Save 8 Mother for the moment. The Illumin coming in to help down. Restoration, Bouncing Sun, 8 Mother. Still very, very low. He does take a fall at the end of the day. And maybe they get a little bit more here. The supports are rotated up. One hiding up in the tree line, the other one a little bit further back. Illuminate spam is going to slow it down. They're so far away. Put the 5 men chasing into the tree lines just to kill off Frigately. Now, he's got nothing to help him survive this one. He knows it. He dies in the tree line, and they will bring down this tier 1 tower.
Yeah, that's one of those situations where you just, if you see 5 people like that, you just go, well, you're dead, buddy. I'm sorry. We're not teleporting in. We're not going to do any of that.
Coming in again. That's a Doombringer arriving. They're going to try and have a crank here at somebody. He uses a Troll Trap, and now the Doom over on the face is void. Where's his support, though? It's 8 Mother returning with the Plasma Field. Mayweather will go down, and now he'll take the right click damage away from Sash, but then again, with the Crypt Swarm, he's got all the damage required, but he's giving so much of it away. 8 Mother's going to be able to turn around and kill off this Wishbuster with just one hit off the Plasma Field. It brings down one. He goes for Troll Warlord, aka Viper. But he can't finish the job. He needs movement speed. He's got Tranquil Boots only. There's not enough movement speed.
Well, it turns out okay, because they're going to get a deny on the tier 1 tower off of that trade. They not only kill the... Did they? They did not kill the Faceless Void, correct? No, they did. Doom was able to finish off the Faceless Void. The Death Prophet went down as well. So two heroes denied tower. That's perfect. I mean, they also got the middle tower with the Naga Siren, who already has 3k gold by 12 minutes. That's going to be a Radiance by 20 minutes, even if she's delayed slightly by a gank.
Yeah. Actually, surprising, I wasn't even thinking about how much the Naga Siren was picking up during that, because she never came.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it would have been so easy if the easy skill was just a TP top lane, let off the Song of the Siren, and the entire fight on top lane would have stopped. But Coast was like, maybe we have enough, we could fight this. Like, even if we lose a couple of heroes, we know the trade-offs are getting better.
Yeah, I think this is one of those sort of things where you read the situation. If lanes had gone a little bit more as expected if VDVoem had done better in the laning phase. I don't think Coast would have tried to take that initial fight at all. I think they would have just let it go and play for farm. But because they did well enough in their laning phase, they knew they could take the fight. Because the Razor was able to pick up such a fast mech and come back into that team fight and force another one, they just were able to make sure that no tower went down. Now you're going to see, again, more 5-man rotations from VDVoem, but all this is going to result in, even if they do get some tower gold here and there, they're going to be massively far behind in experience, and I'm not even sure if they'll be ahead in gold.
I don't think they will be. I don't think they can even take this mid-tower. They're about to lose most of their creep wave, a large portion of their life points. Okay, they do have the tower. The SD Disruption, 8-Mother comes in. Void, he jumps on Sceptile's Well as Frigoli. But the SD Disruption was already used, and 8-Mother starts taking away the damage from Faceless Void. Wish Doctor will throw the ulti out as well, and 8-Mother, he's stuck here for a little bit too long. But the Sash, he's already got the Tomb over on him. One more Plasma Field should actually ensure the death of both the Witch Doctor as well as... Yep, there he goes, Death Prophet. And Roshan, 8-Mother, stay clear of him. Void, for some reason, stuck over on the tree line. He can't get back down again. He doesn't have enough mana. Even with the Intel Tread Switch, he can't get back down again. He's stuck here until he can TP, which is in 20 mana.
So he's going to be stuck there for at least another 10 seconds, which is unfortunate. Lost farming time plus a lost team fight. And sure enough, you could see the way that both the experience dropping heavily in the favor of Coast now, and gold still in the favor of Coast as well. So just because they're taking those towers doesn't actually mean much, especially up against the Naga Siren. If they'd been able to successfully gank the Naga Siren, or at least make sure their Death Prophet didn't die in the middle so much, the Naga Siren would have had a much harder time in lane, and you wouldn't see this Naga be able to spread out through the map. The problem is Naga Siren is already such a fast farming carry when you have maxed out mirror images and Riptide. Once he has this radius, he's going to be nigh unstoppable, and it doesn't matter how quickly you take these towers, Naga Siren will still be out farming you and be ahead in net worth, and probably some of our allies as well. I mean, Doom is another great hero who keeps up his net worth despite a high amount of action due to a maxed out Devourer build.
Yeah, look at the top net worth, 7.2, 5.8, 5.4, and then do you hit the crop at 4.9. They need to force a team fight, but it's going to get to a point anyway where Easy Skills is one creep wave away from having Radiance. He should probably buy a TP in to try and stop this fight in the bottom lane. Or he just says screw it and says, no, lead the boys to defense. Sceptile with his Illuminate. He's even using Ghost Form to make sure the whole pack can lich. Dropped out of 250 life points of his 625 with just one Illuminate spray. They don't even need the Naga because they know they can hold it out with the Coddle.
Look at them. They're actually moving out to try and force the fight. So they're going to go for Sash and already catching him out with the Doom. This is going to be a lost team fight.
Void looking for the Chrono as well. Who's he going to go on? Disruption going to keep him out of this engagement. And Wish Doctor Ultimate is actually quite nice, but it's only hitting on 8-Mother. However, they need to get the kill before he's ever get 6 charges and Mankov. Solon low on life, but living on 22 life points, lifting himself away. Now he can blink himself further away to safety. So Codes get out after killing up the Void, after baiting out both Chrono as well as Wish Doctor Ultimate. And they never had to bring in Easy Skills, who has just Radiance flying out in the courier. And we'll take a tier 1 tower on top lane because they can defend against him.
Yeah, that's why the Blink Dagger is so strong on Doom against certain heroes like Death Prophet who need a bit. And if you catch him out, silence them for the team fight, and she is never able to use Exorcism, or even if she does, she comes to it into the team fight very, very late. It's, you've just completely crushed him. The moment Doom went out, it was just instantly a lost team fight for VDVoem. The only reason it didn't go worse is because the Witch Doctor placed a beautiful Death Ward there, combined with a very fortunate Chronosphere that threatened Coast enough they had to back up.
Yeah. But threatened was all it really was. You saw that was a full duration Death Ward being hit into 8-Mother and only 8-Mother, and they couldn't bring down the Razor. The Razor is just
Radiance
so fat that
you start
to worry, where is the damage output coming from this Radiant side? It's not there from the Viper, obviously, because he had to go in towards the back. The Exorcism is basically level 2, so it at least comes out from Sash, but Sash is going to be really careful about getting, well, doomed up at the very, very start of the engagement and controlled and killed.
Yeah, and you're beginning to deal with some very high armor
Courier's about to be
heroes.
Scouting out Troll Warlord. Okay, does he get Courier kill? Nope, he actually missed it. which means the Doombringer. Okay, well, they need some extra help. Eight Mothers under attack right now. Plasma Field almost enough to kill off all, but now he'll neck charge up. And well, SD waiting for the right time to do that. SD Disruption saves him from Witch Doctor's ultimate, and now Doom comes in. Ulti's over on Troll Warlord, and that's of course the Viper. Lucioli will fly out, but it's well away from anybody else, so the Doombringer just kites it out. We slowed up a little bit, but it's enough with the Death Prophet coming in for the kill. That Exorcism trying to find some extra kills as well, but okay, so what do we really get from this one? Curse had a large amount of commitment, but they still didn't bring in the Naga Siren, who's still farming up on top lane, and you got a kill on a Doombringer.
That was vdvoem, like, catching somebody out. They started going on the Razor. Sure, it took so long to kill the Razor, or go for him, that they didn't actually finish him off, and in the end, Coast were able to respond Radiant effectively, but that was still vdvoem having a favorable initiation to
this
team fight, and they
still
lost.
Time bottom lane, man. Naga Siren's finally got her ultimate back off cooldown again, so she TP's in right now, and she's able to catch up most of... okay, now they're all TP'ing up for her. They don't even get the tower. Eight Mothers moving forward, but every single person TP'd out to come to top lane.
And immediately, Coast link themselves forward, start aggressively pushing out because they realized that there was at least one or two teleports. They're going to try and catch somebody. Unfortunately, vdvoem have already gotten back to their base, but Coast will then just push in the bottom lane as much as possible, and that's going to force vdvoem to go to bottom lane. And then the Naga Siren will have, well, pretty much the whole entire map to farm.
And even a regeneration rune coming in for the Naga Siren after buying BTs. This means Naga Siren is basically immortal because you've got both recall as well as BT, so it's just keeping her fully up.
Yeah, I mean, imagine the clutch scenario where she's getting low, pops her ultimate, pops the regen, and then just continues to fight once when she's back to full health and full mana.
Yeah.
I mean, that's an entire possibility. Coast, it's greedy of them. The safer play would be them to just sit back and do this four push bottom while Naga Siren continues to farm up. But honestly, they're so far ahead, they could conceivably bring the Naga Siren to the next team fight, win it, and probably push uphill from there.
Doombringer finally found the creep he was searching for. It's a double initiation now. He got himself a centaur. It was actually left by the Naga Siren so he could just devour it up. So they get the aura as well as having the stomp. We basically turned Doombringer into regenerating silencing with Doom Centaur.
Well, you have no instant stuns from vdvoem, so there's a good chance your Blink Centaur stun will work. It's a long animation, but there is no instant stuns from vdvoem.
Mesmo coming, does see 8 Mother. He's the first one towards the front lines, and they're really grouped up. Void jumped out, going for the corner, but the Doom is over on Death Prophet. That's going to be completely useless, but the Lich Ultimate just as useless. Witch Doctor now throws out his own ultimate. That'll bring down Sol, but the Illumina really hitting hard at Mayweather. Are they going to keep forcing this one? Mayweather is so low on 47 life points. And Sev style, okay, they're backing up because look at mid lane. Easy skills took a tier 2 tower. The top lane has already been forced out a lot. So again, there's another big fight with almost every ult, in fact, it was every single ultimate from the Radiant side being used. And they only got the kill on the Doombringer.
The biggest problem is you look at vdvoem's lineup by themselves, you would say that it's very strong. It's got a lot of synergy between their heroes. The initiation of Void mixed in with a sustain offered to you from a Witch Doctor with maxed out Voodoo and a Viper who has mech should make Death Prophet tanky as all hell. The problem is they can't do any damage because they're dealing with high armor heroes. Razor, you know, decently high armor, but he always goes for a mech. So that makes him even tankier to all that physical damage. Naga Siren has exceptionally high armor in the first place, so that's going to be hard to kill her. The two supports are sitting in the back. They're very, very far back in team fights, so they're not going to be caught out by Exorcism. And the last one, the only one they can really kill, who is somewhat squishy to vdvoem, is that Doom, because Doom is actually the lowest armor in the game. He starts out with absolutely nothing, but he's making up for that by, first of all, going for the blink and being an initiator, so he dies in order to ensure a favorable team fight for his team, but he also goes for the blads. So he actually got himself a little bit of armor.
Problem is that aura just disappears, but at the same time, he's the only person that really capitalized off it, apart from the creep wave a little bit. But really, at the same time, you're right, he's just a sacrificial lamb that just jumps in. He's almost playing a role like a Venomancer. Get your ultimate off, and then do a little bit of stickiness, and then that's it.
Yeah.
The rest of the team will take care of the rest, and because you've got Naga Siren who can come in at any point, be it through recall as well as BTs, with the Illuminum Plasma Field, then even if we do see a 5-1 by the Radiant side, how do you push up against Plasma Field as well as Illuminate, as well as Riptide? Even going high ground up against Coast is going to be a mammoth effort to even breach, let alone take a tier 3 tower. Because they can just spam from range Coast. They can just take out creep wave after creep wave without putting themselves at risk. And once Devstyle's got his Aghanim Scepter, then it's going to get even worse for him.
Yeah, if this game was closer, VDVoem would still be in some serious trouble because Radiant's the problem is they now have to fall back on going late game, but they have very little to deal with the split pushing Naga Siren. Faces Void, Radiant's if he was actually around the same net worth as Naga Siren, sure. You could conceivably catch her out with the Chronosphere and go for the kill. The problem is he's so far behind, and he's pretty much the only hero. There are no other heroes from VDVoem that are good at dealing with split push. Viper is single target focused, so he can't stop creep waves very quickly. Exorcism is not something you want to be able to commit and then just get Song of Siren ulted and end up losing your ultimate for nothing. Same goes, like, Lich and Witch Doctor are simply not heroes good at catching people out. They're Lich is a good lane dominator and gives you the Lich armor to make you tankier, and Witch Doctor is all about sustained mixed in with a physical damage when you have a Faceless Void ultimate, but there's nothing to catch out the Naga, and this is going to continue for quite some time. Coast are going to finish up the Manta. Well, he's already got that.
Yep.
So he's got all of his split pushing items. The last item is usually a heart, and that is all you really need. Then you can end the game.
Yeah. I'm wondering, even in this game, like, if you just go straight in for the heart, or if you just consider going in for a Diffusal Blade, you are very, very far up. But it's that early harassment I'm thinking on the Faceless Void. This guy's got no extra big items, so you don't have an Aghanim Scepter, so his mana pool is still 390. Mm-hmm. Even just a little bit of harassment from the Naga Siren onto Mayweather takes away one of the biggest ultimate, in fact, their biggest ultimate controller they've got.
Mm-hmm. I would say still go for the heart, just because you are confident enough to go, if I have a heart, even if they do get amazing Chronosphere, they can't kill me.
True.
Yeah, he's like, the high amount of armor. There's no real magic damage coming out from VDVoem, unless it's this amazing Chain Frost from Lich that bounces between a creep and the Naga Siren over and over again. There's not a whole lot of magic damage. Like, Viper has some, Lich has some, the rest is physical damage. So you got some big issues in being able to pop this Naga Siren real quickly, and that's not even to mention any of the other heroes such as Razor, who are equally tanky at this point.
Naga is currently illusionally taking out the tier 3 tower of the top lane, and there is so little that the Sash can do about it. While on the bottom lane, the tier 2 tower has been slowly whittled away. The Catapult, looking for the last hit. They just have to go for the Denial right now.
Radiant's
in fact, there it is. The Viper able
denied.
To get the Denial
Radiant's
off.
Middle tower is under attack.
But Sol, I don't know if you also noticed, Tim. He's just been sitting back farming up the entire time.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's just been farming time after time and gets himself a plate mail up and running.
More armor.
He was just sitting at the Agents for like last 2-3 minutes.
Yeah, he has been.
I'm also really surprised too that Coast haven't even looked towards Roshan. Like, they have the dire side advantage, but they haven't actually used it at all. They're keeping the lanes pressured out more than anything else. Maybe they're worried that, like, one failed Roshan fight could find themselves in a sticky position.
Yeah, I mean, the only way to throw this game, I think, would be going for certain bad scenarios, like a preemptive Roshan, where you get caught by a big Faceless Void ultimate and this amazing Chain Frost, etc., etc. So I think they could pull it off, but at the same time, it's probably unnecessary for them. We're also going to get some additional sustain for Team Coast, and that is going to be behind the Keeper of the Light, who is about to finish up an Aghanim Scepter. So you don't see this very often. I mean, Caudill is rarely seen in the meta right now anyway, but having an Aghanim's finished up for the Keeper of the Light is very rare indeed, but just goes to show how much room Coast have been offered this game.
They could have actually given him that a little bit earlier. I don't know if you watched the combination on the bottom lane before, just when they're forcing out the towers, it was Illuminum, then followed up by a Plasma Field. But if you did it the other way around, you would have actually skyrocketed the farm of Stevstyle.
Mm-hmm.
But they put more money into the Razor instead, which kind of like they didn't actually have to do because he already had the Aghanims when they were doing that. So they could have actually been walking around with double Aghanims. But you've got 2,000 gold over at Ape Mother. He can finish a BKB and freely walk inside the base. Then again, maybe in this game, BKB actually isn't the greatest thing in the world for Razor either.
I don't think BKB is necessary. I think it's more likely that Coast are going to play this very disciplined. They're going to finish up the hard on Naga Siren, go for the refresher on Razor, have the Aghanims for the Caudal, you know, the smaller things like that. Shiva's for the Doom is actually very important as well. But once they have those big items, they've reached a kind of peak of power where they just overwhelm VDVoem and going uphill. And there's pretty much literally no way they can lose a team fight at that point. Yeah.
Just waiting until they're ready to go high ground.
Yep. And when you realize, when you're in these sort of scenarios sitting
shake
back.
Shake the build.
Oh, he went to players.
Okay. Yeah. Sorry. I. Yeah.
That's okay. I was wrong about. wrong about Tranquil Boots earlier. Now we have a Diffusal Naga. First game of the day.
To be honest, though, I 100% agree with you. Like, a heart would be a very, very normal thing for the Naga Siren to build into. Yeah. Beautiful thing about Dota, you can never have a wrong build.
So when you're in these sort of scenarios, I just want to point out this to people. You have this amazing item. If you go to your shop and you type in the word smoke, it's amazing for these sort of scenarios, because what is essentially happened is you are trapped inside of your base. If you move out without smoke, they know. Coast have these really good aggressive wards. They also have all the abilities in the world to keep creep waves pushed without endangering their heroes in any way. So there's no way you can catch them out when they push the wave real quickly. So and there's no way for you to move out past the creep wave without being detected. So you need to be able to go for smoke in these sort of scenarios, because if the enemy team is just stalling out and they're not pushing, there's a reason for that. And that's because they feel confident enough that they are going to farm up the rest of their items and then go uphill, and they will be unstoppable at that point in time. So you need to actually try and interfere with that any way you can. And so going for a five-man smoke gank into the bottom lane or something like that, just try and catch out the Naga Siren or force a 4v5, anything at this point, because really all that's happening is you are enduring a very slow death. And you can't just sit back and accept that. You need to start moving out. You need to try and, you know, interrupt this just chain of you waiting for creep waves to push into your base, farming them up, and then waiting for the next one. Because while you're doing that, you're farming up maybe 200 gold per minute on your three cores, while the rest, all of Coast are farming 300 to 500 gold per minute by utilizing the rest of the map.
Yep. You want to know how much Coast, like, believe in their farm and their item builds? Yeah, you're saying, like, Hart should be over on the Naga Siren, who's now hunting a Radiant Courier. It's the fact that...
He's got both.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a great thing. Okay, they just recalled the wrong thing.
That could be intentional.
What, recalling an illusion?
Yeah, this is actually an old-school strat where you would recall, like, Terror Blade illusions in order to push out. So Terror Blade on one side, Terror Blade illusion on the other. It's stupid how much farm you get from that point in time.
Just it because, actually was. He just took an entire creep wave of the bottom lane just from recalling an illusion.
Yeah, you would do that with Phantom Lancer illusions as well, because Phantom Lancer illusions are even better because they propagate themselves. You can actually get one illusion, put it into the bottom lane, and create an army from there if you don't already have an army top.
Yeah. To finish thinking
the
about,
old Phantom Lancer.
To about E-Skills, he actually... he bought up both the Vitality Booster and the Recipe for the Heart, and then he actually built the Diffusal Blade.
Why not? He went back to base. Well, now he's gonna go bottom.
Easy pickup, throw him around.
He might actually try and go uphill.
But they should go high ground right now. There it is, Blink, Doom, and that's made where they're already down. Does he have buyback right now? And the answer is no. He's short by 750 gold, and this will probably be the end right now of the Radiant side. Lipjolty on top. They can take up most of this. Lipjolty will continue to bounce itself around inside the heroes, which is that split up a little bit more. Solemn Ape Mother, Wish of the Rolly is going to go off, but then at the same time, he's just dying to the Lightning Storm Ape Mother, who does actually take a fall at the end of the day. The Solemn's coming in, they're looking for the follow-up kills, and they're going to get one. Viper being slowed down, the Crimson Swarm is actually doing some decent damage, but at the same time, E-Skills just stopped him for a moment, comes in close, and gets the kill. He'll die towards the tower right now, or will he? Low on life.
Too much armor!
SC Disruption. Try to save him. Sol is still taking it up too. Mirror images. And you try and stay away from Troll Warlord. One final attack will get the kill from the Viper. And now they're looking to turn around. Not damage, but a buyback BT. Nice Chrono. Gonna pick up Stem Style. The Illuminate will still fly out. He's managed to backtrack that damage while E-Skills, Yule's up dropping towards the air. Disruption, capture, and it's gonna be over on the Faceless Void. But there's still trouble for the Nagasari. She's not home at host yet. But then again, with the amount of damage she's dishing out to both Sash as well as the Lich. Lich had to back himself out this one. Trigger Link getting bashed up on the time log. E-Skills, maybe enough life points, not enough life points, but with the illusions, he gets the kill on the Death Prophet. So buyback spent for both Viper as well as Death Prophet. They hold their bottom ranks, however, which considering the position of this game is quite an achievement.
It is actually. They blew two buybacks in order to ensure that. Naga Siren also had a pretty fatal misplay buying back and then teleporting into pretty much
the middle of the team.
Three of VDVoem getting maledicted and just kited around constantly. VDVoem are lucky that Coz tried to force a fight, is what it comes down to, because they just actually got a lot back. They gained a lot of experience out of that. I don't think they came ahead necessarily in gold, but experience-wise, this is big. And experience is important for heroes like Faceless Void, but especially Death Prophet. Level 3 Exorcism gives you a peak. Viper can benefit from it somewhat. Having your level 3 Viper Strike is very beneficial once you have your Aghanims. Unfortunately, Troll Warlord is very far away from that. He's actually going for a BKB before he goes for the Aghs, which is obviously not the ideal build. It's very similar to going like a BKB on Storm Spirit, which is like, you don't want to have to commit to a magic immunity because you shouldn't be ever be far enough behind that you have to go for a BKB on a Viper. Normally, your corrosive skin and plus mech, your natural tankiness should be able to carry you through, and you can go for a more better damage dealing item.
And bottom lane, they're prepping to arrive again. Stemstyle is going to recall in. Well, does he even bring in the Naga at this point? He's trying to just get Frigali to come and join the rest of them. This Frigali is using Shadow Poison to push out the middle lane. But they're ready to fight. Illuminate to just kill off the creep wave. Oh, and they found Mayweather. Wonderful blink in by Doombringer. That's just also up by the aggressive ward up on top of the hill. This guy right here. And that means with the Faceless Void down, no buyback available, they can just go high ground. Hey, that force up didn't take the Lich where he thought he would go. The plastic field's already dropping down very, very low on life, and Doombringer looking to capitalize. Level dead, very quick damage. The bouncing card's gonna cause some problems too, but then Yule Scepter seeing the Razor up and towards the air. We've already turned the ultimate on. And that Krob ulti is doing very little apart from taking out the creep wave, but Aegon doesn't care about that one when Doombringer comes to get a perfect stomp over on the Witch Doctor and Mass GG. The top lane's being forced out by Naga Siren. They're just being destroyed in all fights.
Yeah, he's just taking the top lane casually while his team finally forces a much better fight than the other one they took last time. And they could have waited for Heart on Naga Siren and then gone for the push. They could have waited for a refresher on Razor, but simply put, Coz Gaming just outplayed VDVoem so hard that they didn't need to wait for those sort of things. And we're able to just end this 35 minutes in. Not bad for a Naga Siren game, right? It could